tens of thousands, but one that's been on the news, and he blew my mind on Fox just recently. Check out Dr. Sucharit Bhakdi on Ingram Angle. Take a look at this.
For all these policies, lockdowns, social distancing, which in your view has been the most injurious to the public and not suited to the science?
The looming vaccination.
Tonight, Anthony Fauci on this network actually said that 75% of Americans are going to have to get vaccinated to reach what they call herd immunity. Do you buy that?
What utter nonsense. Someone who says this has not the slightest inkling of the basics of immunology. And this is very, very surprising for someone of Dr. Fauci's standing. And I would dare to defy him anywhere in the world at any time. But I cannot do this in 2 minutes.
Well, so you believe that the COVID vaccine is not necessary?
I think it's downright dangerous. And I warn you, if you go along these lines, you are going to go to your doom.
Whoa. Those are heavy words from a scientist on Fox News. But once again, I am not Fox News. I am not MSNBC. We are not CNN. We are the high wire. So guess what? I've got Dr. Sucharit Bhakdi joining me now, and I'm not going to make him say it in 2 minutes. For those of you that really want to know what a virologist and award-winning researcher has to say about this, why don't we ask him? Dr. Sucharit Bhakdi, I want to thank you again for joining us once again and taking the time.
Thank you for having me.
Now, I want to begin this conversation just for those people that should ask the obvious question. Are you anti-vaccine?
Not. I'm pro-vaccine. I have been teaching this for 30 years, and one of the first things I tell my students is that the vaccines that work against tetanus, against diphtheria, against polio, have been a godsend. And you have to try to understand how they work, and then you have to use them. But if a toxin is doomed to fail, and doomed to claim lives and claim of people, you have to do everything to stop it. And this is the case with this damn COVID vaccine.
You know, and for those people that watch the show, we cover it all, right? I mean, I know that those of you that are out there that are like, I want vaccines wiped off the face of the planet, you watch the show. But for those of you that believe in vaccines, I want you watching the show. The information is for everybody. I want everybody to understand from whatever perspective you're coming from, what we're talking about is a scientist here that doesn't just generally decide to, you know, say this vaccine is dangerous. Has a belief in the process and the use of them. So let me ask you more specifically then, what is it about this vaccine that is not fitting into the category of those vaccines you would normally celebrate? What is it that scares you about this vaccine?
Well, first of all, in order for a vaccine to pass the scrutiny of the authorities like the FDA, or the European authorities, it has to be shown to be efficacious and to protect. All right, you know, if you get tetanus, if 100 people get tetanus, 90 are going to die, all right, if they're not vaccinated. But if they're vaccinated, no one will die. Now that is efficaciousness, that is efficacy. Similar for diphtheria, all right. Now, in the case of COVID-19, if you are under 70 and you get the virus, your chances of dying are less than 0.1%. This is now internationally acknowledged, and John Ioannidis, one of the foremost epidemiologists in the world of Stanford, has published this, and this has appeared on the bulletin of the WHO in October. So anyone who doubts this is doubting a world authority. And this is impossible. The fact is that you are virtually not able to die if you are under 70 and have no serious pre-existing illness. All right, so now, how in the world are you going to prove that a vaccine is efficacious if you can't prove protection against severe illness and death? And in fact, this is what has not been done, and therefore this vaccine must not be authorized. It must not be, the FDA is not allowed to pass it. It's not doing its job. You know, there has recently been a very, very good article in the British Medical Journal addressing this very issue. And the title of the paper is, Will COVID-19 Vaccines Save Lives? Current trials are not designed to tell us. So if they're not designed to tell us, and they haven't told us this, what are we talking about?
Great
you
point.
See, the so only...
Right. This is not efficacious. You cannot prove it being efficacious. And I think mathematically, I mean, just from, and I'm not like a mathematical genius, but in order to prove that the vaccine performs better than nature, you're going to have to prove that you can raise that mortality rate from the, you know, 0.02%, or depending on what group you're in. I mean, we're talking about 99.97%, or in youth, 99.997% survive it. How do you prove a vaccine is able to affect that 0.003%? I mean, you'd have to like vaccinate millions, right, to ever even see if you have it be efficacious, and then it would be questionable.
I think, Adele, that anyone who's watching us now has to realize that the permission to use this vaccine is criminal. To give permission to use this vaccine is criminal, first of all right? And I dare to say this in front of any audience in the world and before any court in the world. And I tell you that this is being taken to court in Europe in any way. Now, you see, if you want to protect the elderly with pre-existing illness who are at danger, really at danger, if they're not correctly, as Dr. Zelenko just said in his beautiful and his so impressive interview, with agents that are so safe and so easy to use and so efficacious. Now, if you want to use a vaccine instead of hydroxychloroquine or ivermectin, then okay. It's going to be much, much more expensive, but if it is as good, all right. And if someone prefers to have a shot instead of having hydroxychloroquine and ivermectin, also okay. But before you do this, you better go and show that this vaccine is tolerated by the patients and is efficacious. And this, of course, has never even been looked at. It's never been thought about what the people are going to do. You use these vaccines that have not been tested and have not been certified, you know, without dangerous side effects. This, again, what is happening is that the world is being turned into an animal experiment house. It's not even a house, it's our world. And you and our children are being the animals that are being tested, the hugest experiment ever been done in the history of medicine is being performed on men, on people. This is the thing that is so scandalous, and so horrifying that any politicians want to go for this, that any authorities, any medical people will say this is the right way to go, is such a frightening, horrifying thought to me as a doctor.
And let me ask you this, Dr. Bhakdi. Let's say, you know, we were able to catapult you into, you know, a powerful position in the White House, the United States of America, or, you know, Parliament, and say, Dr. Bhakdi, you're in charge of establishing both efficacy and safety. But let's put efficacy aside for the moment. I think that that would be very difficult, would take millions. But what would you need to see in order, you know, what would you be looking for? What trials would need to be done for you to sign off and say, I like the COVID-19 vaccine, it's safe, you should go out and get it? What processes need to happen in your mind, and what are your greatest concerns that you would want to be testing for?
Well, to tell the truth, I would never, ever put my bet on a vaccine against COVID-19 because I know that it's bound to fail. Now, why do I know this? You see, the idea about our immune system works against viruses is very fuzzy. Who knows about this? You know, we took great pains to write a chapter in our book that explains immunity against viruses for you, because this is something that Fauci himself does not understand, or at least doesn't seem to understand, because what he's saying reveals to us that he doesn't know about this, and this is too bad. So my hope is that some of you will pick up this book, read that chapter, and lo and behold, in 2 hours, you will know more than Fauci, which I think is a great thought, isn't it? You will know more than he does. So first of all, look, I'll try to explain this in very easy words, if I have the time to. All right. Fauci, this is the virus, all right? This is the antibody. You need your antibodies to catch the virus so the virus can't enter your cell. My head is the cell, all right? So if you don't have antibodies, the virus will enter your head. It'll be multiplied in your head. It will come out again and then infect the next heads around us, okay? And that's it, then you're dead. And therefore, he wants herd immunity. He wants to be vaccinated so people have, so that 75% of the people running around have antibodies, will catch the virus in time, and so the infection cannot go to your head. But this is extremely naive, you see, because what Fauci obviously does not know is that the interaction of the antibody and the virus is a one-to-one thing. It's like a football team, okay? You have one guy and he catches the others, and but both are then caught. The antibody is caught. Now, what happens, dear Mr. Fauci, when a second virus comes by and the first antibody has been caught in combat? Because that antibody can't free itself. Once it's bound, it's bound. The simple answer is, the wall of antibodies is going to be overrun by the opponents. Do you understand? Have I made myself clear? It's a matter of dose. If the viral load is high, you can have these antibodies in your blood. They will not prevent the infection. And that is why there is no real proof that any virus that enters by the airway can be prevented from entering the cells that it wants to infect, which are the cells lining the airway epithelium, because there simply are not enough viruses and not enough antibodies to stop those viruses, and therefore you are going to get that virus in your cell. Now, what people obviously do not know, including, is that once the virus has entered the cell and multiplied so that you get ill. Now you get your cough, you get your fever, and if Dr. Zelenko is not around to give you chloroquine, it'll get worse and worse and worse. True, but even people who did not get hydroxychloroquine, did not get ivermectin, got well again. How did that happen? It happened because, you see, once a virus is being produced in your cell, my head is the cell, while it's being produced, waste products are created. It's like a house. When you build a house, you have these waste products coming down that you throw away, okay? You garbage. So the cell puts these waste products in front of its door. Now, my glasses are the waste products of the virus. So new viruses come out, but the waste products are presented in front of the door. Now, every one of you has lymphocytes. And among these lymphocytes, you have killer lymphocytes. Killer lymphocytes are white blood cells in your blood, in your spleen, in your lymph, that are able to recognize these waste products that are presented in front of the door. And when the patrol comes along and sees that there's a waste product in front of the door, the killer lymphocyte says, something wrong is going on, guys, let's go. And then they approach the cell, and then there's this kiss of death. The kiss of death kills the cell. And with that, tree is destroyed, the fire is extinguished, the virus is no longer produced in your cell, and then something wonderful happens. You see, a killer lymphocyte then detaches from the head and goes to the next cell that's infected. So the killer lymphocyte is much more effective than an antibody. It kills many, many cells that are infected by the same virus, but it will always recognize only that virus for which it's trained. And so you have a whole army of killer lymphocytes that recognize garbage created by coronaviruses. Now, this COVID-19 or SARS-CoV-2 virus is labeled a new virus, but in fact it isn't. It isn't any newer than, let's say, you know, if a child is born onto you, it's a new human, yes, but it's still a human. And so that human looks like you and me. And you see, the new SARS-CoV-2, the waste products of that SARS-CoV-2 look very similar to the waste products of the old virus. And all of you have been constantly going into battle, into fights with all these coronaviruses that have been around all the time. And so you can bet your life that you have killer lymphocytes that recognize this waste of the new coronavirus. Now, we wrote this in our book, and we said we believe that is why it is so damn difficult to die of this virus, all right? Am I being clear? Have I made myself completely clear?
I can tell you right now, the audience is typing in and they're blown away, because this is, I mean, I'm learning something right now. This is what I love about the show. It's hard to understand these things, right? Like, we don't get it. You've been looking at this your whole life. But and you help me understand something, because I was talking to a top virologist recently explaining exactly this. We don't know what antibodies actually have to do with this. We're seeing people that are in amongst infected people. They should be getting it. They appear to be fighting it off easily, but they're not having antibodies. That there may not be antibody production, yet something in their bodies is fighting this illness. And you're saying it very well could be this killer lymphocyte.
Of course. This is how the immune system works against viruses that don't kill you. That's why we can coexist with the viruses, and that's what you have your killer lymphocytes for. You know, in the first immunology lecture, I would ask my students, they would all be sitting there, you know, with their mouths open, what do you think your killer lymphocytes kill? And everyone said, oh, I think they kill the bacteria, the bugs. And I said, that's exactly the wrong answer. That if you give me that answer in the exam, I'm going to fail you. Okay? Killer lymphocytes kill your cells that are infected, and they also kill tumors, the recognized tumor cells. All right, now, but anyway, because by the way, the waste of the tumor cells looks a bit different from the waste of the normal cells. I'm not going to tumor cells now. So let's go back to this damn virus. It's not new. We wrote in a German book that we thought, and that was back in May, that was the reason why people did not get seriously ill and people did not die. Now, after our German book had appeared in June, 4 weeks later, a string of papers appeared in the literature that said what we thought was reality, because many groups showed that whoever you tested, whether in America, whether in Sweden, whether in Germany, you could take lymphocytes from people, blood that had been taken before 2019, before this virus was born, all right? And they tested these lymphocytes to see whether those lymphocytes would recognize the waste of the new virus. And lo and dies, what do you think they found? Yes. And the biggest study was in Tübingen, Germany, this blessed country. And they showed that 80% of the normal Germans, young Germans, who had never ever seen COVID-19 because it didn't exist at that time, the blood samples had been taken back in 2015, 16, 17. Can you imagine that?
Let me ask you a question, and I'm going to out myself. And again, folks, I've always said I'm not a doctor. I'm a journalist trying to understand this with the rest of you, asking real questions. I've seen articles about cross-reactive T-cell immunity. Is this lymphocyte? Is that the same thing we're talking about?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, precisely. Now, there are people who say, yeah, they do cross-reactive. We don't know whether they're responsible for immunity. I say, okay, of course we don't know for certain, but it's damn probable, because this is how immunity works. Why should they recognize it and not do anything about it? Why should they?
Right.
That's what they're born to do. Okay, so, but this is it. And you see, some people come and tell me, they found it in only 50 to 80% of the individuals running around in the blood samples. Then I'm going to tell you, okay, that over 90% of your lymphocytes are not in your blood at this moment. And if you draw your blood, okay, you'll be missing over 90%, because over 90% are in your lymphoid, lymph nodes, spleen, liver, whatever you want, but not in the blood. So if 80% of you guys running around have these lymphocytes already in your blood, which is less than 10% of the lymphocytes, you can bet your life that the other 20% also have them in their spleen and lymph nodes. And I am ready to bet my life on this, because there are indirect, very clear signs that this is the case, you see. The big danger about this vaccine is you are shooting the gene of the virus into your body. It's going to go through the body and go to entering cells that you don't know. These cells are going to start making not the whole virus, but virus protein. And these cells are going to put the waste of that spike protein in front of their cells. And the killer lymphocytes will see the waste. And, you know, anyone who doesn't understand that there's going to be an auto attack because the killer lymphocytes are already there, excuse me, it's with this that I will say, bye-bye, because you don't realize that what you're going to do is you are going to plant the seed of autoimmune reactions. And I tell you, for Christmas, don't do this. The dear Lord did not want humans, not even Fauci, to go around injecting foreign genes into the body, because the dear Lord made these killer lymphocytes for you to see the cells that are daring to make this, all right? Have I made myself completely clear?
Yes. Yeah, quite terrifying, and I think as clear as I've ever heard it stated.
Horrifying.
You are a great teacher.
It's horrifying.
It is. I want to thank you for that. We will continue to have you on and teach us more about this as we enter the new year. I'm sure this story is not going away. Thank you again, as I said to Vladimir Zelenko, I said at the top of the show, I want to celebrate the people that are not looking the other way just because some authoritarian figure or health department is saying we all need to get behind this. You are stepping up to and attempting to save people's lives and attempting to educate us so we know what it is really happening here. So thank you so much, Dr. Sucharit Bhakdi, for taking the time.
Welcome. God bless you.
God bless you too.
If you like that clip, then be sure to check out our live broadcast of the